11. On that night, the king could not sleep, and he gave orders to bring the book of records, the annals, and they were read to the king. It was found written how Mordecai had told about Bigthanah and Teresh, two of the king's eunuchs, who guarded the threshold and who had conspired to assassinate King Ahasuerus. And the king said, "What honor or distinction has been bestowed on Mordecai for this?" The king's servants who attended him said, "Nothing has been done for him." The king said, "Who's in the court?" Now Haman had just entered the outer court of the king's palace to speak to the king about having Mordecai hanged on the gallows that he had prepared for him. So the king's servants told him, "Haman is here, standing in the court." The king said, "Let him come in." So Haman came in, and the king said to him, "What shall be done for the man whom the king wishes to honor?" Haman said to himself, "Who would the king wish to honor more than me?" So Haman said to the king, "For the man whom the king wishes to honor, let the royal robes be brought, which the king has worn, and a horse that the king has ridden, with a royal crown on its head. Let the robes of the horse be handed over to one of the king's most noble officials. Let him robe the man whom the king wishes to honor, and let him conduct the man on horseback in the open square of the city, proclaiming before him, 'Thus shall it be done for the man whom the king wishes to honor.'" Then the king said to Haman, "Quickly take the robes and the horse as you've said, and do so to the Jew Mordecai, who sits at the king's gate. Leave out nothing that you've mentioned." So Haman took the robes and the horse and rode Mordecai and led him riding through the open square of the city, proclaiming, "Thus shall it be done for the man whom the king wishes to honor." Now we turn to the Gospel of Luke. We're reading Luke 16, 19 through 31. Another great reversal. Jesus says, "There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and who feasted sumptuously every day. And at his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, covered with sores, who longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs would come and lick his sores. The poor man died and was carried away by the angels to be with Abraham. The rich man also died and was buried in Hades, where he was being tormented. He looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. He called out, 'Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I'm in agony in these flames.' But Abraham said, 'Child, remember that during your lifetime you received your good things, and Lazarus, in like manner, evil things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. Besides all this, between you and us, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who might want to pass from here to you cannot do so, and no one can cross from there to us.' He said, 'Then, Father, I beg you to send him to my father's house, for I have five brothers, that he may warn them so they will not also come into this place of torment.' Abraham replied, 'They have Moses and the prophets. They should listen to them.' He said, 'No, Father Abraham, but if someone goes to them from the dead, they will repent.' He said to him, 'If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced, even if someone today's sermon is titled The Traumatic Reversal. St. Mark summarizes the beginning of Jesus' Galilean ministry with the following verse. Now, after John the Baptist was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." In his book, Jesus, the Apocalyptic Prophet of the New Millennium, Erman argues quite effectively, in my opinion, that Jesus began his ministry to deliver an urgent apocalyptic message to humankind. The old age, the kingdom of Satan on earth, is ending. And a new age, the kingdom of God, is beginning. And Jesus not only was the herald of the new age, the kingdom of God, but also he firmly believed the agent of the coming of the kingdom of God on earth. And as Jesus instructed us, we pray every day, just as we did this morning, that God's kingdom come, God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What's the nature of God's kingdom? What distinguishes God's kingdom on earth from the rule of Satan? Again, we looked at the Lord's Prayer for an answer. God's kingdom will come fully on earth when God's will is done fully on earth as it is in heaven. In other words, when sin and death are defeated, God's ultimate victory over the demonic forces of Satan, then we will see and experience God's kingdom on earth. We will. Jesus' urgent message to us is to realize that he has begun the process of bringing God's kingdom to earth, that we should repent, turn away from sin, and accept the grace of God through his crucifixion, death, and resurrection. We know Jesus has conquered these final enemies, and soon he will return and judge the quick and the dead. So yes, Jesus warns us, get ready. Repent. Prepare for the coming of the kingdom of God, for the time is at hand. Now, what will this kingdom of God look like when it comes to be present fully on earth? Jesus spent his entire ministry answering this question in his teachings, in his acts of teaching and of healing and of casting out demons. It's our opportunity to encounter his message in the pages of the Holy Bible. We can read what the kingdom of heaven on earth will be like. Jesus will be fully with us. We will be in the midst of God. We have this opportunity to find his message in the Holy Bible. When we read the Gospels, we find carefully preserved for us through two millennia the good news of Jesus Christ, the Gospel. Consider Jesus' words in the Beatitudes. Those are the first verses from Matthew 5. We read them together just a few minutes ago. They open the Sermon on the Mount. They tell us about a dramatic reversal. Did you see that? A dramatic reversal that will occur when God's kingdom comes. Those who presently are poor in spirit will be exalted in the kingdom of God. Those who mourn now will be comforted, and the meek, those who submit their own will to God's will, shall inherit the earth. Those who hunger and thirst for righteousness will be satisfied. The merciful shall obtain mercy. The pure in heart shall see God. The peacemakers will be blessed and called sons of God, and those who are currently being persecuted. Christ, you're going to be exalted in the kingdom of God. The message is pretty clear, isn't it? When the kingdom of God comes to earth, there will be a dramatic reversal. Those who are at present on top will be brought low, and those who are oppressed will be exalted. So no wonder when Jesus was born, Mary sang to God in prayer, he's brought down the powerful from their thrones, lifted up the lowly, he's filled the hungry with good things, and sent the rich away empty. He's helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy. Throughout his ministry, Jesus told us in no uncertain terms about this dramatic reversal. He taught his disciples to focus on the needs of others, not on exalting themselves. This is how they and we are to prepare for the coming of the kingdom. This is tough for me. It may be for you. I've got lots of pride. That I should humble myself. That's tough. That's tough. But that's what Jesus says. Humble yourself. Do for others. Don't exalt yourself. Here are a few samples of Jesus' teaching. Notice how they hammer home this particular theme. Here's Mark 9:35. Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant. Mark 10:42-45. You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it's not so among you. Whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. Luke 9:48. Whoever welcomes this child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me for the least among you. He's the greatest. Luke 18:14. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. Matthew 25:12 and Luke 14:11. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled. All who humble themselves will be exalted. Pretty consistent message, would you say? Pretty consistent. Here's Matthew 18:4. Whoever becomes humble like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Commenting on these in similar himself. He's already envisioning, you see, himself in royal robes with a crown on his head. Haman answers eagerly for the man whom the king wishes to honor. Let royal robes be brought, which the king has worn, and a horse that the king has ridden, with a royal crown on his head, and let the robes and the horse be handed over to one of the king's most noble officials, and let him robe the man whom the king wishes to honor, and let him conduct the man on horseback throughout the open square of the city, proclaiming before him, thus shall it be done for the man comes a dramatic reversal, doesn't it? The king says to Haman, okay, quickly, take the robes and the horse, as you said, and do so to the Jew Mordecai, who sits at the king's gate. Leave out nothing you mentioned. Jesus says, all who exalt themselves will be humbled, but all who humble themselves will be exalted. The book of Esther continues with reversal after reversal, with the final result being that Haman is executed on the very gallows that he had built for Mordecai. Mordecai becomes the king's trusted advisor, and Esther, the Jewish servant girl, Mordecai's niece, becomes the queen of Persia, and she influences King Ahasuerus to free her people from oppression. That's quite a story, isn't it? That's quite a story. May God's kingdom come indeed. I invite you to read that book of Esther. It's short and fun, delightful. Read it as a comedy, because that's what it is. It's a parable told us about what the kingdom of heaven will be like, about the dramatic reversal that shall come to those who seek their own honor rather than the care of others. Now we can turn to the second illustration. Here's another one, a dramatic reversal. It's Jesus' parable of Lazarus and the rich man. We know that story pretty well, don't we? Know that story? The rich man, dressed in purple and fine linen, that's the clothing of a king, dining sumptuously every day, he's too busy exalting himself to notice that humble Lazarus, all covered with sores, who's laying at his gate. Lazarus longed to satisfy his hunger with what fell from the rich man's table, Jesus tells us. Then comes that dramatic reversal. Both men die. The poor man is carried away by the angels to heaven, where he rests in the bosom of Abraham. But the rich man is buried in Hades, where he's tormented night and day by burning flames. And when he sees Lazarus far away by the side of Abraham, the rich man cries out, Father Abraham hath mercy. Then Jesus told his disciples, Matthew 16. Then Jesus told his disciples, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. Those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit if they gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? Well, the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly, I tell you, there's some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Words from the lips of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Oh dear, Heavenly Father, we ask that your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And as we pray this prayer, oh God, help us to realize its meaning, that we are praying for the dramatic reversal of those who humble themselves before you will be exalted, and those who exalt themselves will be honored. Jesus, only begotten Son of God, we thank you for your warning. You've risen from the dead to bring in the kingdom of God, and we must listen to you before it is too late. Be with us, strengthen us as we seek to do your will. Lead us to repentance, the life everlasting. Aid us as we seek to do your will by feeding the poor, giving the thirsty something to drink, welcoming the stranger, clothing the naked, caring for the sick and visiting the prisoner. Help us, O Holy Spirit. Help us to take up our cross daily and follow Jesus. Give us the spirit of a servant so that we might partake of the grace of God. In Jesus' name.